morning and welcome to Church of the Epiphany here in Lebanon, Tennessee. So glad you could join us today. I'd like to provide a few announcements for the good of the order. First of all, you all may know we are not actually at church right now. This is a recording that is being played on Sunday morning, so don't worry, you're not missing out. This is Saturday, really, and we have a few people here that we're having worship. If you saw the e-blast, you know what is happening. So glad you could watch the video, and I'm glad y'all could come again. Thank you for being here. A few announcements. First of all, I want to just let you know what a wonderful send-off last week we had for my husband at his congregation to send him off to his new place. He felt very loved and appreciated, and it was a good event. Thank you for letting me go. And we also give thanks for Father Bill, who came here and was able to provide for you all the word and sacrament. So thank you, Father Bill, for that. And let's see, a few other announcements. Next Sunday is a big Sunday for us. For the Bishop of Tennessee, Bishop John Bauerschmidt will be here to preach and to celebrate and to come and see us. The entire Diocese of Tennessee will be praying for us next week. So you'll see that in the prayers of the people. For the prayers follow the bishop, wherever the bishop is. That's the folks we're praying for that week. So that our week is next Sunday. So I hope you can make it. We will be having a luncheon following. It's not potluck. This is really confusing to folks because we always do a potluck when the bishop comes. But we decided we want a potluck when we do our annual meeting to encourage folks to come to our annual meeting. So next week we'll have lasagna. And if you wouldn't mind sending a RSVP to the sign-up genius if you think you will be coming, so we make sure we have enough lasagna after church. So that's next Sunday. Also next week is the Diocesan Convention of the Diocese of Tennessee, and your delegates from here, from this church, will be going. It is me, as your priest, and Susan Johnston, and actually Pace Polk, who is an alternate, will also be going to represent us. Amelia Hips is our regular delegate, but she's had to drop out because of health issues with her family. And so Pace is stepping up. Thank you, Pace. So that's where we'll be next Friday and Saturday. Y'all pray for us. It's a long day, but it'll be fun because we haven't seen each other in 2 years, the diocese, so we're excited to see some friends and just kind of touch base. So pray for us next Friday and Saturday. We have moved the annual meeting in potluck to March. We think that because of the rise in COVID, folks aren't coming as much. They want to stay safe, which is great, you know. But maybe by March, our numbers will have declined and we'll not have so many cases here in Wilson County and in our country. Let's see, we are still doing our food pantry collection, and I was reminded that we hadn't announced that, but it is still continuing. So if you wish to bring food anytime, but especially the third Sunday, which is actually today, would be this week normally. So we'll fudge that and make sure to announce it next week. But if you want to bring food, please do. We'll get it to Joseph's storehouse. I think that's it. All right, let us quiet our hearts as we prepare to worship the risen Christ.
Thank you.
God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, grant that your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, may shine with the radiance of Christ's glory, that he may be known, worshiped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest until her vindication shines out like the dawn and her salvation like a burning torch. The nations shall see your vindication, and all the kings your glory. And you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no more be termed forsaken, and your land shall no more be termed desolate. But you shall be called, my delight is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a young woman, so shall your builder marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's psalm is Psalm 36, verses 5 through 10. Let us read responsibly by half verse. Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your righteousness is like the strong mountains, your justice like the great deep.
You save the man who needs the Lord.
How priceless is your love, O God.
Your people take refuge under the shadow of your wings.
They feast upon the abundance of your house.
You give them drink from the river of your delights.
For with you is the well of life. Continue your loving kindness to those who know you.
And your favor to those who are true of heart.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were enticed and led astray to idols that could not speak. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God ever says, "Let Jesus be cursed." And no one can say, "Jesus is Lord," except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them and everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit of the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. And to another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the discernment of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of the tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. The word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come." Now standing there were six stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first and the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk, but you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Good morning. Good morning. I always giggle at this story, don't you? There are Baptists and Methodists just rolling over. It's not really wine, it's grape juice that he turned that to. Well, okay. I won't say any more about that. But today, actually, what I'd like to look at is the book of Isaiah. How often do we talk about the book of Isaiah? We don't very often. And so today, I would like to look at the major prophet Isaiah. Major because it's long, 65 chapters. So it's one of the five major prophets in the Old Testament. And Isaiah is the most quoted in the New Testament. Jesus quoted Isaiah frequently, as did Paul in his letters to the churches. Well, today, if you want to look on in your bulletins, we read about Zion and about Jerusalem. This is the prophet Isaiah speaking from God's voice, although it's not clear. So this is what he says. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent. For Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest until her vindication shines out like the dawn and her salvation like a burning torch. The nations shall see your vindication and all the kings your glory, and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. This passage is a profound passage. Let's back up and think about Jerusalem and the land of Judah and Israel. And how was history for them? It was rough. Israel suffered greatly for centuries, millennia, honestly. I remember visiting Jerusalem a few years ago on a Holy Land trip. And there was an archaeological site next to the Temple Mount in the city of David, which is the right next to. This is Zion is the mountain on which Jerusalem sits, okay? So we were there looking at this display, and it had all the layers of sediment from the 12 civilizations that had occupied Jerusalem. Jerusalem had been beat up, put down, killed, and treated poorly for a long time. Was it the Babylonians coming in? The Assyrians? Was it the Egyptians? And finally, well, the Romans. We know about the Romans. And then the Islamic world. For a long time, Crusaders came by. I mean, I can't even remember them all. I'm probably going to mix them up. But that's a lot of people coming in and a lot of oppression, a lot of pain and suffering. It was tough to live in those days. It was tough. But here, in this reading, we see that God was telling them something. He was telling them, this is not the end of your story. I have something for you. I have redemption. I will redeem you. I will not rest until you are redeemed. The nations will see your vindication and all the kings your glory. You know, after being down here, the Lord says, no, one day you will be an object of glory and beauty. You will not be called forsaken. You will have a new name. You will be termed my delight. Your land married Beulah. You remember Beulah? Beulah land. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. Anyway, Jerusalem would be restored. And it is the vision of hope and of redemption that God would rejoice over them. Here in the season after the Epiphany and before Lent, we have the season of the manifestation of God, the appearance of the Lord to first the wise men. But here in the wedding of Cana, Jesus' first sign, we see that he can do wonders and he can do miracles and he can change nature. And it's a vision of God's appearance in the world. And we also ponder in this season how we too manifest the glory of God through the Spirit. We receive the Spirit that is given for the common good of all. And when we carry, another metaphor is to carry the gospel in jars of clay. You know, we're not all that special, are we? You know, we're just people. But within us, we carry the glory of God with us where we go. For the light, for the world to see and to be drawn to the glory of God and to be themselves transformed. Now we think about our current situation in the world. We think about Kroger. There are no deli meats right now at Kroger. No bread. It's light. If you need something, you might be in trouble with the snow coming. And what about the saber rattling that we read about in the news among the nations? And how COVID has just devastated us as a world, as a nation, even Tennessee. We've lost so many, even recently. And it continues. And then our divisions, Americans against each other here in this nation, name calling and unpleasantness. It's always a dangerous thing to check out the Hip Lebanon Facebook page. I don't recommend it, unless you're looking to buy something. But anyway, someone was describing something that had happened to one of their children at school and was making threats on this Facebook page. And then other parents are getting in with them and just, I'm appalled at the behavior of some of the folks on this Facebook thing. Facebook page. And I'm just reminded that we are a depraved humanity. You know, all of us are in need of redemption. But that is not the end of our story. The difficulties we find ourselves in, they are common to humanity. They will not end tomorrow. And our hope is not in that ending. Our hope is in God and God's coming redemption that he has set before us. And that is our hope. If we read at the end here, it says, as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. God rejoices over you. You and you and me. We are loved so deeply. And not just us, but every single image-bearing human being out there. And they need him. And guess who has the gospel within us? It's us. God wants to use us to help folks find a new way. Find his way. And so that is what I'd like to leave you with, an invitation to say, God, I want to reveal, to manifest your glory. I want to live in this redemptive life that is already here, but is also not yet here. So may the Lord imprint this new hope within you, in your heart, and may the Lord help you reveal it, manifest it to others. Amen. And now, let us reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the
Prayers of the People, our Form 5. Father, we pray to you for your Holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in heaven.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. We pray for our members of our congregation, Craig, Linda, Frank, Lois, Pat, Ann, Kenny, Amelia and Jim, James, our friends and loved ones, Linda and Barbara, Claudette, Sharon, Karen, Kay, Marty, Virginia, Ronnie, Fred, Lillian, Edie, and anyone else you would like to name. Caleb Burnett. Those in long-term care, Kathy, Wyleen, Betty, Marjorie, and Caroline. And our first responders and those in military service and their families, Ben, Jonathan, Trevor, Mallory, Sean, and Dalton. For those having birthdays this month, Matthew, Abigail, Catherine, James, Ann, Jim, Ben, Kitty, Wayne, Ellen, and Jim. We pray for those celebrating the anniversary of their marriage, John and Kathy. In the Diocesan Circle of Prayer, we pray for Church of the Holy Trinity, Nashville, and the 190th Convention of the Diocese of Tennessee.
On this Martin Luther King Jr. weekend, let us pray. Almighty God, who created us in your own image, grant us grace fearlessly to contend against evil and to make no peace with oppression, and that we may reverently use our freedom, help us to employ it in the maintenance of justice in our communities and among the nations, to the glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship.